viewers, we thank God there is God that we are able to continue. But just to say, those out there, whenever the journalists come to you, help them so that they can give out information to our viewers, because our viewers at times need you. And so, if you are not there for them, make things very difficult. We shall be taking the Anglophone problem where we are looking at it, who should have the blame, who to blame in the Anglophone problem. Is it the colonialists, is it the fathers of independence, or the political activists we have today? Those are the views we have. So we want to have your idea. What do you think? Who should have the blame for the Anglophone problem today? Mr. Njomo Cyril, we've had situations where some people take the problem of the Anglophones today to be from independence, and those who fought for the independence of Cameroon, what they did at that time, and some individuals have the blame. Some people say it is the colonial masters that manipulated the fathers of independence. Some people say it should be the political activists today. They are not united in their ideologies. Even when they come, they are just for their stomach and so on. Now, I want to have your view.
Thank you, Mr. Mambo. I promise on the same platform that I was to talk about the Marwa Bamenda agenda. But before I talk, permit me draw reference from the post-colonial era. 1960 to 1972, after I will skip from 1982 to 1985, after I will skip to 1990 to 1997 2004 2011 2018, and where we are. First, 1960 to 1972, I will mention, is that first of all, there's one thing that the whole people who are following us should never forget. It's about the partition of Africa, where after World War II, nation had to sit down and decide. Just like when you fry an egg and you are in the house with five children, you take your saucisson knife and decide to cut. This one is going to join, this one is going to... That's how they cut. So everybody was picking his part as per his interest that he has started developing there. That is how Cameroon came to France and Britain. And in that light now, you see that there was no genuine, there was no biological relationship between those who now became master of their colonies and those who initially were origin from those particular colonies. That is the first thing. That's a fateful morning, you get up and hear that you have a new father. And he start giving you order. Those who dare resisted their order were simply assassinated, were killed. It's going to pull through to when they finally give us our independence for the Francophone region in 1960 and for Southern Cameroon in 1961. And during the independence of Southern Cameroon, Funchal, who led the issue, will choose to merge with his brother of the Francophone region. In short, let's say he won an election and finally they say he has to merge with, and Endeli had preferred that Southern Cameroon should rather join their borders in Nigeria, because part of Southern Cameroon today is in Nigeria. And so Funchal had a good mindset. He wanted that since we have once lived together, we should come back again together and be one. But that the heritage of each part should be maintained. But Aicho agenda, because Aicho has never struggled for any part. You never read any part of history, except the one written by Julian Gore, where you will see that Ahidjo won any election before becoming president. Bida is the one who won any election.
Bida did a lot of
pressure. Are you getting me? Bida is the one. So a man was then graced with the position of the new president of La République, of French Cameroon. And so, with an agenda, of course. And so, he is going to use the assimilative agenda or leadership style to struggle to penetrate the Anglophone. I want to really cut the memory because if you see well, in the days of the UPC when they were fighting, most of the UPC that had to fly for exile passed through the Mungo Stream to southern Cameroon before they found their way to Nigeria. That was the process. But since Ahidjo had as agenda number one to assimilate that part of the country, because he was told, if nationalists continue to prosper in your land, they will always easily smuggle through southern Cameroon to find their way, because there's no one, the issue of Mumi to ever repeat itself again. Because when Mumi went to the diaspora, Mumi was one of the strong father of UPC. When he went to the diaspora, he became very powerful, and he was influencing the leadership of Ahidjo back home. He was assassinated through poison. It's not really the topic of today. So they will gradually pull like that, and there are three actors in the in southern Cameroon that will become very instrumental for Ahidjo agenda to assimilate southern Cameroon. Take it and take it well. You have Estimuna. You have Jongu Foncha. And you have Ngomjua. You can add to that list other people. My own little history that I've read, that's what they have told me. And so, am I forgetting this name? From 1961 to 1965, they will be using Foncha and working with Foncha, but Foncha will gradually be discovering that they are gradually changing. They will start with the house, attacking the House of Chief.
Yeah.
Attack parastatals, attacks companies that used to exist in southern Cameroon. And Foncha will start rebelling. He will start decrying. Then they went to the extent of nominating a vice president and told Foncha that he needs to step down as the leader of southern Cameroon and occupy the vice president. And they will go later and bring up now Estimuna and tell him that he should make a proposal between Estimuna and Ngomjua, who is going to now be heading the governor of southern Cameroon. And he's going to suggest Ngomjua, but they are going to play and choose Estimuna. They are going to pull through like that up to 1972, when they forcefully went to Northwest and Southwest, major city, Bamenda, Manfe, Boya, and some other few, and force election onto the people. And the election will give, which is what they call referendum, it will give 99 in most of the region. That is the result that they will now force other citizens, those who vote and those who did not vote, that it was a general accession. That is how now they united the two Cameroon into one, what Ahidjo will call reunification.
Yeah, before I come to Dr.
1982, Mambo, yes. I listed my point before I started. Okay. You could have subtracted from there.
Okay.
1982 now, Ahidjo is going to give up. He's going to pass power to Mr. Bia. Mr. Bia will take over, and by 1984, he's going to do what I call, until somebody prove me wrong, he is going to pretend that there's a coup d'etat, but there was never a coup d'etat. He organized that because he wanted to change the leadership. I'm revealing something very terrible on your platform today. I'm telling you, he organized because up to today, all those who are said to have orchestrated the coup d'etat were later, where they were jailed. For example, Tiroma Bakari and the other one, there are about three of them that have successfully maintained their position in government up to today. They were jailed for some few years and they were graced, not even up to 4 years. By 1987, they were already out. And that is how they were graced, and up to then they have maintained their position. What I want to explain here is that Bia came in with the same agenda because he has never won any election to become president. He was equally past by his elder brother. So he will
maybe
maintain that same,
prove to us.
He will maintain that same agenda that Ahidjo had to assimilate the Southern Cameroon, but his own will become very terrible because he will decide to go to Bamenda to launch the CPTM. And he will tell the Anglophone that it's because he loved the Anglophone so much. So initially the Anglophone will say, wow, truly, that somebody should come and give birth to a party that is going to rule over the nation means that no, truly he has force at heart. After that, when he is went through the election in 1997, he will be he will discover that the northerners of this country have a strong agenda. He is going to move there also and give them the name, the first girl child of the CPTM, meaning that, you know, when you are the first girl of a family, the kind of prestige that you are, in French they call la fille aînée du renouveau, meaning that you are the eye of the new system of government. And that is how these two major demographic dividends community are going to lower their ego to the caprices of the CPTN and notably to Mr. Biapol, that is going to compress them over the year. Most of their political elites are going to be enrolled into the CPTN machinery and gradually grind over the years. Within that time, there is the SCNC that have grown, people who have never loved to be part of anything concerning the French, that will be growing since post-independence. Early 1961, there were already voices that were against. And that voice will be developing until 2006. First of all, in 1993, with the All Anglophone General Conference, AAC1, AAC2, in 1994, and Anglophone will be making their proposals, some of which will be considered in 1996, during the draft constitution of 1996. And surprisingly, we will discover that Pope Biya will not be respecting, especially the aspect of decentralization. And Anglophone will still realize that over the years, the same, even though they partake, they gave their own resolution for the AAC 1 and AAC 2 of 1993 and 1994, that future in the 1996 constitution, they will still discover that their rights, for example, documents are still in one language. For example, you are still having lawyers from the Francophone that have been trained in a different system of government, I mean, ruling in the Anglophone region, for example, and that is going to proceed up to 2016, when the lawyers, for example, will take onto the street and start denouncing those kind of facts. And surprisingly, they are going to be fierce. They are going to be fierce with brutality. And it is from then that Chicha had to take over. And that is what we call the open crisis of the Anglophone. But 4 years down lane, has anything changed? The answer is no. Nothing has actually changed. Despite the fact that Mr. Biya went to for the peace conference in Paris and told openly the world that truly there have been an agenda to assimilate the Anglophone, but he has finally discovered that 2 cubes of sugar cannot melt inside that bucket of water. And we were expecting that he should do something. He came and organized a monologue, invited some of the prolific leaders of contemporary times. I will not give them the largesse to be naming them, because personally I was hurted when I saw some figures there. And after that event, they are nowhere to be found. Their reputation were watered down by participating through that event, because the true proponents, those who took the extremist position, those who were revolutionized and took extremist position, they were extradited from Nigeria and put today what we generally term the Naira 10. And Mr. Mwambo Williams, we have finally reached a certain point where the Naira 10 now is being contested by self-proclaimed leaders on social media. And okay. Children that are born today, if we are not careful, because the social media is a new economy where there's a war on social media, they would think that it is those people making noise on social media that actually handled the Anglophone crisis.
Okay,
which is
you have talked from the time of the colonialists' rights to maybe the time of the Fathers of Independence and maybe to the political activists. I'll come back to you with the questions I had. Let me usher in Dr. Busi. As far as this is concerned, there has been this loggerhead who has really caused this Anglophone problem that some people say it is from independence, given the colonialist behavior, and some people say the activists we have today in the political scene are doing nothing.
Before I answer your question, Mr. Moderator, I don't know, we're running against time, and I feel that you must always make your time balance. Because you have
I'm running the program.
You have to balance your time. Maybe the panelist is very important. If you like, continue with him.
What I can say,
I can leave the program.
Before the baby is crying.
Who is the baby here? I can leave the program, Mr. Mambo. If you don't know how to moderate your program, I can leave. I will leave, sir. If you don't know how to moderate your program, I will leave. No, please, you have some respect for me. And you don't say it and baby is talking. You are using him, please. It's not a matter of information. You are supposed to, as a moderator, intervene and balance your time. We don't have time.
For his to talk for 2 minutes something is not
enough. And they cannot say that it's a baby. Who is a baby here?
I know what I want.
No, you're not correct.
Okay, just if you say something again to
moderating your program balancing time, I will not come here again.
When we use those kind of statement, it does not
literally. It's not correct. We should be responsible because not want a baby. I'm not a baby, I'm a matron man. We should be responsible, yes, sir. And you yourself as a moderator should learn how to moderate well.
Are almost corrupting our mind, and we need to be
very careful. Cannot moderate program one person talks for all the time.
They show that they are making on social media.
I will not talk to the end of the program.
Okay, Mera, focus on them. They have the impression that truly they master the Anglophone cause and that they are really fighting for the Anglophone cause. No. They have set their own agenda and they are fighting mostly for Gombo. It has nothing to do with the plight of the people.
Okay.
And I can tell you one more with facts. Having dined on certain table with some elites of this Southwest region or of this region, I can tell you with fact that what the layman is going through is totally different from what the political elite is struggling for in Yaounde.
Okay, now, I wanted to ask you, you analyzed from the time of the colonialists to the time of the Fathers of Independence, right, to the activists today.
Right.
Don't you think that, oh, you talk of Foncha, you talked of Gonjoa, you talked of Muna. Now, at this time, you know, by 1959, Muna and their team has won, that is, they were under Foncha, has won to as prime minister. Now, don't you think that at this time Indeli was sidelined? So these people that you've hailed that they worked with Ahidjo, who should have the blame here?
Oh, if you want to take it from that perspective, I cannot blame Foncha. Just like some people are saying that if Sisiku Ayu finally yield to the government call for dialogue, he will have replaced Foncha 1961 mistake. No, I cannot blame Foncha in the history of this country. Because truly, Foncha was a gentleman. He believed genuinely that the move he was taking was to reconcile one person, people who have been together for some time before. You understand? So it was not truly a selfish agenda.
Some writers say Ahidjo was able to play on Foncha and the rest because especially Foncha, who was the head, was an illiterate, according to some history. But Indeli was very educated, who they feared him at that time.
You can see what our scholars have given us today. Life is not about you. We respect scholars for the research they do about the society. But when problems set up, we also expect them to provide concrete solutions. COVID-19 is one of the problems that the world have known. How many of the medicine do you know have been cured by any professor around the world?
Do you see the political activists of today to not solving the core problem? Do you see as a problem on their side?
I would first of all not like the word political activists. Yes, because to be a politician, you need an agenda. Yes. When you are a politician, you have an agenda. And so secessionists that we have today, they are after an agenda. People have blamed Funzi for have sold the SDF and traveled abroad. Truly, it's his own agenda. Today, another person, maybe Ernest Moi, have created his own political party. He was following the CPTN also for an agenda because of what he has seen his own fathers and what you call today political activity doing. But I want to tell you that beside all of that bite and blow game, there is truly a political movement. There is truly a political engagement that necessitates somebody to struggle for an ideology until that ideology finally emerges to be the ruling ideology. We have seen it in South Africa, where people who supported Nelson Mandela had to wait for 27 years until his leadership had to take over. We were happy in 2008 when, for the first time in the history of Black America, a Black American could emerge as president of the United States.
Okay. I want to say on this, we shall still be coming on dialogue on this topic, given that we are out of time and it's a serious topic that we really need to talk on. Dear viewers, we will say we will come to the end of this program today, Cross Views. We want to say with time, we shall make sure that we get so many of these analysts here so that you have an insight and you have their views who should have the blame, whether it is the colonialists, the fathers of independence, or the political activists of today, so that our problem in Cameroon should be solved. I want to say I've been moderator Mambo William. We shall see you next time.
You are watching CMTV.